It's true. Your Second Amendment rights are perhaps in more danger now than ever. But here's the deal. You can't just talk the talk. You got to walk the walk. And in this video, I'm going to share with you six ways that you can protect your Second Amendment rights with real action that'll have a real impact. But I'm going to warn you, tip number five is definitely going to ruffle some feathers. So check this out. What's up, Warriors? It is Jeff from warriorlife.com, and yes, we are in the midst of yet another super crisis when it comes to the Second Amendment. We're always in crisis, right? But now it's a super crisis. We've got a lot of reasons why. So we have a Democrat in the White House right now who has literally said on the campaign trail that they're coming for guns, and high-capacity magazines should be illegal, and these weapons of war should be illegal. We've already seen that. But now we have a Democrat-controlled House and a Democrat-controlled Senate as well. But public perception is also ramping up. So we've had the siege on the Capitol with people dressed up in animal skins and freaking tactical gear. And the public perception is that these are a bunch of whack jobs and we need to take their guns away from them because they're crazy gun nuts. We've also had pro-gun demonstrations around Capitols with, again, people coming out there in tactical gear, parading AR-15s and AK-47s up and down the street, again, giving public perception that there's a bunch of gun nuts out there, and we need to vote out the pro-gun representatives and bring our own people in, and we need to get these things off the streets. We have other things that are working against this as well. So the number one watchdog that we've kind of focused in on is the NRA, and the NRA just filed bankruptcy. So we have a lot of things working against us right now, which means that it puts more of the onus back on you and me. And there really are things that you can do that would have a real impact that you can protect your Second Amendment rights. I'm going to give you six of those things right now. All right, tip number one is to join the NRA anyway, even though they just filed for bankruptcy. Okay, listen, I've had my share of complaints about some of the things that the NRA has done or not done over the years, but I've been a lifetime member, so I still believe in them. I still think they're going to pull their way out of this. And look, the constitutional fight for Second Amendment rights happens in the courtroom. And after my last divorce, I learned what a sucky lawyer I am. So I'm counting on lobbyists and people who are really going to be in the courts to do the job that we need them to do on the big picture to be able to handle it. They're going to need our donations more than ever. Of course, I want them to be responsible with my donations. And NRA, you're going to have to do that. You're going to have to kind of shore up the bank account there. But I believe they're going to be able to do it, and they're going to pull themselves out. So join the NRA anyway. Tip number two is to buy a bannable gun now. So we already know what guns are typically on the chopping block, and those are things like AR-15s and AK-47s, high-capacity magazines. So those are the ones that you would most likely be worried about being taken away from you. I'm not worried about the government coming into our homes and prying their, you know, our rifles, our AR-15s out of our cold, dead fingers. I'm not worried about that. In fact, they realize that they're not going to be able to do that. But there are going to be other things that can be done. When we saw in 1994 with the assault weapons ban, they didn't have everybody turn in their weapons. What they did was they banned any new purchase of those types of weapons and the sale of any of those types of weapons. So what that means is if you've got them, you'll be able to keep them. I know that right now with the ammo crisis and everybody's afraid of the Second Amendment rights being taken away, but if you can afford one right now, go ahead and get one. If you already have them, and if you don't have to worry about like a stockpile of them, but hey, hold on to what you've got because you most likely are going to be able to keep that going forward. Tip number three is to contact your state and local representatives. Now, I know this seems like, you know, what does my voice really count here? But the one thing that politicians want more than anything is to preserve their own lifestyle and to get reelected so they can go to all the fancy parties and have all the power and the influence. So it's up to you to contact your state and local representative and ask them, how do they feel about your gun rights? How do they feel about the Second Amendment? Ask the question. Now, don't call them up talking about how you need that right because you are going to stand up to a tyrannical government and you need your muskets and your 50 caliber sniper rifle to be able to make sure that our country stays free. But what you can do is call up with any personal reason that you have. So, for example, you might be an avid hunter. You might be somebody that likes competitive shooting or target shooting. Or it might even be that you've experienced some sort of an assault or you want your family to be safe. Any personal stories that you have, even if it's a friend's story about how there was a home invasion, we all know that when seconds count, the police are going to be minutes away. So these are the types of things, these personal stories are what is going to give you most traction when it comes to stating your case to your local representatives, and you don't come off as some kind of gun nut whack job that's just trying, you know, overthrow the government. So stay personal with it, but definitely reach out and contact them and expect some sort of a reply. Maybe not from them, but from a staff member, and you make your voice known. All right, tip number four is going to amplify your voice, and that is for you to join some sort of competitive shooting or a shooting club that's out there. So here's the thing, even when you contact your representative, yes, you're one voice, but it's an important voice. Use your voice. But they also know that that one voice can multiply exponentially online, but you don't want to get into like the forums and start talking all kinds of gun nut crap. What you want to do is you want to be part of a club and let that representative know that you're part of a shooting club with 3,000 members or a local competitive shooting network that has 5,000 members. Like, what they care most about is the number of votes. They know they need volume of votes. So if you're part of an organization, they know that your voice and the response that you get back from them is going to be amplified by networking with other like-minded patriots like us. And those are the people that when word gets out and that person gets that representative gets a bad reputation for anti-gun stance, then those votes are going to really count to them. Okay, tip number five is where I really start to piss some people off, all right? And that is, don't be a dumbass with your gun. You don't just have gun rights, you have gun responsibilities. That means that you have to act lawfully with your weapon, even if it is a justified shooting. And I can tell you from talking with people in training classes, even guys who have been carrying a gun forever and consider themselves, you know, red, white, and blue, knuckle-dragging, chest-thumping gun experts, right? Sometimes have very little idea about what it takes to be lawfully justified when it is that you pull your weapon out or pull the trigger. Now, I have seen this even when I've taken classes before, how the instructors don't even necessarily know what those legal things are, right? The question is whether or not you know it. Because if you do one little mistake, even if it's a justified shooting, and you're found guilty in a court of law, because you didn't do something right, if you're convicted of a felony, you're not going to be able to own your guns, perhaps ever again. Your family is going to go through all of the turmoil, all the stress, all the tension. You're going to lose tens of thousands of dollars, even if you're found innocent, in legal costs. So you definitely need to make sure that you aren't the number one reason of why you get stripped of your Second Amendment rights. Now, that means the responsibility is on your back. You don't just have rights, you have responsibility. So you have to be responsible to go out there and get legal training. You need to do as much legal training as you do tactical training. Now, you can get this online. I'm not just talking about signing up for some sort of a legal protection service, which is great if you can do that. I'm talking about actually getting training when it comes to when you can legally use your weapon for justified force. Tip number six kind of scares the bejesus out of me right now, but there's a lot of opportunity for us here to get an even bigger another wave here of Second Amendment support. All right, and that has to do with, we have 7 million, an estimated 7 million new gun owners out there. Now, I'm not talking about people that just bought a new gun. I'm talking about people who never owned a gun before and now they own a gun. And some of these people are going to be from the left because they saw everything on the news over the last year about riots and protests and siege on capitals. Like, they realize that they have to protect themselves as well, so they go out and buy guns. But are they getting the training to go along with it? So this kind of goes back to the legal argument. We got a bunch of people out there without gun training, without tactical training, without legal training, without hardly any training, because we've been in the middle of a pandemic as well, and so all that training isn't as available as it was before. That's kind of scary. So all it takes is, you know, throw a few cases in there of somebody that did something stupid with their gun because they were a first-time gun owner, and that's going to hurt us all, right? But it's also an opportunity. Think about it this way. These new gun owners now have a reason to stick up for the Second Amendment, right? So tip number six is to enlist the newbies. This is the time to talk to them about their Second Amendment rights. And don't talk about overthrowing the government and stuff like that. Talk about personal responsibility. There's a lot of basics that you can teach these people. Show them how to be responsible with their weapon, but also talk with them about how our Second Amendment rights are on the chopping block. And it's up to them to help support their ability to be able to protect themselves and their family. So see this as an opportunity. So take them down to the gun range also. Go shooting with them. Just use their ammo. Have you seen the prices lately, right? So use their ammo. Tell them that you'll give them some instruction if they'll buy the ammo. All right, so that wraps things up, but now I want to hear from you. What are you doing to protect our Second Amendment rights? Go ahead and leave a comment down below the video here. And if you believe in the tips that I just shared with you here, spread the word. Like, hit the little thumbs up button on the video here and share this video with your friends. I mean, we're in a culture war here in the United States right now, and it's one that we can actually lose. So we have to stand united on this, and we have to get the word out. So feel free to share this video with any of your friends or on social media channels so that they can see how they can put real action behind protecting our gun rights. Until our next video, this is Jeff Anderson saying prepare, train, and survive.